on the 16th of June 1904. It's always like this in Dublin, as you know. Fáilteoibh Gaoláir, go on beside na Héireann. I'm Adrian O'Neill, I'm the Irish ambassador. And I'm delighted to welcome you all to the embassy for this special Bloomsday, a day of celebration of James Joyce and his magnum opus, Ulysses. Now, I am completely unqualified to be the person who should speak first on this evening because I have not read Ulysses. And I imagine that I'm not alone in that regard. But I won't embarrass you all and ask you to put your hands up as to who has read it and who has not. It may be on my bucket list. I won't make a commitment about that. But I feel that even if I make a valiant effort, if I get to page 27, that'll be all right, because that's as far as Nora Barnacle got. So page 27, and we're our Catholic guilt is discharged. In recent years, Bloomsday has effectively become Ireland's third national day, after Bridget and Patrick. And I think there's a pleasing irony about the fact that we Irish have chosen to celebrate the anniversary of something that never actually happened, but is entirely fictional in nature. And I think, it demonstrates in the Irish psyche the power of imagination to trump history. But back to this evening's celebration. I'm thrilled to be joined by a fantastic group of participants led by the wonderful Lisa Dwan. And I leave it to Lisa to introduce our cast of readers and performers. Lisa herself is an award-winning Irish performer, director, writer, and scholar, hailed by the New York Times, quote, as the nonpareil interpreter of Samuel Beckett. Now, I have to admit, I didn't know what nonpareil meant. So I looked it up, and it said incomparable or unrivaled, or as we'd say in Dublin, bleeding brilliant. But she has been critically acclaimed for her performances of various Beckett plays. And in addition to Beckett, among other projects, Lisa has more recently starred opposite James Nesbitt in Bloodlands and for the BBC, which was on our screens in the last year or so, and also Lizzie in Top Boy for Netflix. Now, my wife Aisling and I had the great pleasure of attending Happy Days at the Riverside Theatre about this time last year, and a stunning performance by Lisa. And she very kindly, notwithstanding the fact that she was 8 months pregnant at the time, she very kindly hosted a fantastic discussion for a number of our guests after the performance. And since then, she's welcomed into the world her new daughter, Luna Mary. So congratulations. So that's it from me, and it's over to the real proceedings now. So would you please give a warm welcome to Lisa Dwan.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. It really is a privilege to be with you all here this evening to mark the centenary of the publication of Ulysses. So, a century on, and where are we now? We might well ask. We need to ask. We've traveled for a century, and though things have changed utterly, we have in many ways not come very far. Another century on, where will we be? If my baby daughter Luna lives to be 100, as she might well, where will she be? What new novel will she read? In what new world? Will it be written by an AI? Will it surpass all previous novels in its scope? Will it gather together politics, poetry, join the greatest writings of ancient Greece to a new world of language? This is what happened 100 years ago in what T.S. Eliot described as the most important expression which the present age had found, the publication of Ulysses. 100 years on, that achievement has not been surpassed. To Eliot, Joyce's work was so radical, so revolutionary, that he declared that the novel is a form which will no longer serve. Joyce changed the whole landscape of expression with what he had done. Even the very best of writers and artists from that point on scrambled under the pressure of his uniquely spectacular offering to find new methods to capture modern consciousness. To find the form to accommodate the mess. That is the task of the artist now, so said Samuel Beckett. Beckett himself had been a starry-eyed assistant for a near-blind Joyce and almost suffocated under that influence. One quick look at Beckett's posthumously published first novel, Echo's Bones, and it's almost impossible not to notice this overwhelming influence of Joyce's music, tone, imagery, and bawdy humour. When I first met Joyce, I didn't intend to be a writer, Beckett admitted. But I do remember speaking about Joyce's heroic achievement. I had a great admiration for him. That's what it was. Epic, heroic, what he achieved. There is also a story of Beckett wandering the streets of Paris in Joyce's own yellow Italian leather shoes, two sizes too small for him. This is a self-referencing motif that appears in Waiting for Godot, with Estragon suffering from too tight shoes. Because Beckett could not step into Joyce's shoes, as he put it, I realized that Joyce had gone as far as one could go in the direction of knowing more, of being in control of one's material. He was always adding to it. You only have to look at his proofs to see that. I realized that my own way was in impoverishment, in lack of knowledge, in taking away rather than adding. Beckett, like Joyce, fled into self-exile from the sow that eats her farrow for Paris. And between Paris, Zurich, and Trieste, Joyce set those wounds to work, writing at a time when Europe was trying to come to terms with herself, as she is again now. Joyce delved into his own exile to create the deliberate variousness of the Austrian-Hungarian immigrant Leopold Bloom. Bloom is a European wanderer, like the Greek mythological hero Odysseus. I think it's important to remember that today, in celebrating Bloomsday, we are celebrating values of sympathy, diversity, tolerance, and ultimately love. We are welcoming those who have no choice but to wander. While Ulysses follows the form of Homer's Odyssey, Joyce was forensically precise in creating a homage to Dublin, both in its detail and in its characters. He wrote regularly back to his aunt in Dublin to make sure he'd every single detail correct. Had such and such house ivy on the seafront wall? How many steps are there down to the sea? Could a man climb over a certain railing in Eccles Street? And if you ever get a chance to visit the New York Public Library, you should take a look at Nabokov's extraordinary maps of Dublin, drawn only from his reading of Ulysses. In his diligence for detail, his love and loathing and search for this idea of home, he captures something not only unique and universal, but deeply humanly true, where every time we open its pages, we run the risk of taking a long, hard, and often hilarious look at ourselves. There is music in his language, which is nothing short of genius. Joyce's world was full of music. And Ulysses is full of music, with hymns for grand operas or bawdy street ballads heard throughout his work. Joyce himself was a talented tenor and had said that were he not a writer, he could have become a professional singer. So this evening, I'm delighted that we're joined by tenor Robin Tritschler, who will treat us to some songs referred to in Ulysses. We also have the distinct pleasure this evening of witnessing the world premiere of a brand new composition based on Ulysses. Sirensong was commissioned by award-winning Irish saxophonist Robert Finegan, and tonight he will be accompanied in this performance by French soprano and Andrea Bocelli Foundation scholarship recipient Clara Barbier Serrano and British-born Chinese collaborative pianist Tia Ling. Sirensong was composed by Irish composer Rhona Clarke, who's also with us this evening. But most of all, Joyce loved to write people. And this evening, just a few of his 100-plus characters would be brought to life by my fellow participants, Jeremy Irons, Aoife Duffin, Trevor Kaneswaran, Eileen O'Higgins, and Sinéad Cusack. First, Jeremy will kick us off with the opening pages from Ulysses Telemachus, which finds one of our protagonists, Stephen Dedalus, along with his companion, Buck Mulligan, starting their day at the Martello Tower in Sandycove on the south side of Dublin Bay. Jeremy will then be followed by Robin, accompanied by Tia Ling, who will perform Fill the Fluther's Bowl, a playful Percy French number, which features in the book. Trevor Kaneswaran will then introduce us to Leopold Bloom, where we find him at home preparing his breakfast and chatting to his cat. Then we're off to Barney Kiernan's pub, where Aoife's Bloom faces off the citizen with the famous discussion about nationhood and citizenship. Rounding off the first set and lining us up for part two, Robin and Tia will then return for a rendition of Thomas More's Silent O'Moyle, setting us in the National Library, where Stephen Dedalus reflects on feeling of grief and separation. This will be followed by Love's Old Sweet Song, heralding us towards Joyce's women in the second set. Over to you, Jeremy.
Thank you. Stately, plump Buck Mulligan came from the stairhead bearing a bowl of lava on which a mirror and a razor lay crossed. A yellow dressing gown, ungirdled, was sustained gently behind him by the mild morning air. He held the bowl aloft and intoned, "Injuribo ad altari dei." Halted, he peered down the dark winding stairs and called up coarsely, "Calkins, come up, you fearful Jesuits!" Solemnly he came forward and mounted the round gunrest. He faced about and blessed gravely thrice the tower, the surrounding country, and the awaking mountains. Then, catching sight of Stephen Dedalus, he bent towards him and made rapid crosses in the air, gurgling in his throat and shaking his head all. Stephen Dedalus, displeased and sleepy, leaned his arms on the top of the staircase and looked coldly at the shaking, gurgling face that blessed him, equine in its length, and at the light, untonsured hair, grained and hued like pale oak. Buck Mulligan peeped an instant under the mirror and then covered the bowl smartly. "Back to barracks," he said sternly. He added, in a preacher's tone, "For this, so dearly beloved, is the genuine Christine, body and soul and blood and wounds. Slow music, please. Shut your eyes, gents, one moment. A little trouble about those white corpuscles. Silence, all." He peered sideways up and gave a long, low whistle of a call, then paused a while in rapt attention, his even white teeth glistening here and there with gold points. "Chrysostomus!" Two strong, shrill whistles answered through the calm. "Thanks, old chap," he cried briskly. "That'll do nicely. Switch off the current, will you?" He skipped off the gunrest and looked gravely at his watcher, gathering about his legs the loose folds of the gown. The plump, shadowed face and sullen oval jowl recalled a prelate, patron of arts in the Middle Ages. A pleasant smile broke quietly over his lips. "The mockery of it," he said gaily. "Your absurd name, an ancient Greek." He pointed his finger in friendly jest and went over to the parapet, laughing to himself. Stephen Dedalus stepped up, followed him wearily halfway, and sat down on the edge of the gunrest, watching him still as he propped his mirror on the parapet, dropped the brush in the bowl and lathered cheeks and neck. Buck Mulligan's gay voice went on. "My name is absurd too. Malachi Mulligan, two dactyls. But it has a Hellenic ring, hasn't it? Tripping and sunny like the buck himself. We must go to Athens. Will you come if I can get the aunt to fork out 20 quid? He laid his brush aside and, laughing with delight, cried, "Willie, come! The Jesuit!" Ceasing, he began to shave with care. "Tell me, Mulligan," Stephen said quietly. "Yes, my love. How long is Haynes going to stay in this tower?" Buck Mulligan showed the shaven cheek over his right shoulder. "God, isn't he dreadful?" he said frankly. "A ponderous Saxon. He thinks you're not a gentleman. God, these bloody English. Bursting with money and indigestion. Because he comes from Oxford. You know, Daedalus, you have the real Oxford manner, and he can't make you out." "Oh, my name for you is the best. Kinch, the knife blade." He shaved warily over his chin. "He was raving all night about a black panther," Stephen said. "Where is his gun case?" "A woeful lunatic," Mulligan said. "Were you in a funk?" "I was," said Stephen, with energy and growing fear. "Out here in the dark, with a man I don't know, raving and moaning to himself about shooting a black panther. I mean, you saved men from drowning. I'm not a hero. However, if he stays on here, I am off."
Covering the buckle and the shuffle and the cut. Jigs were danced of the very finest quality, when the waiter met the company, a handle in the butt, with a toot on the flute and the twiddle on the fiddle, hopping in the middle like a heron on the griddle, up, up, down, hands around, crossing to the wall. Oh, hadn't we the gaiety and filled the fluters ball?
Mr. Leopold Bloom ate with relish the inner organs of beasts and fowls. He liked thick giblet soup, nutty gizzards, a stuffed roast heart, liver slices fried with crust crumbs, fried hen cod's roes. Most of all, he liked grilled mutton kidneys, which gave to his palate a fine tang of faintly scented urine. Kidneys were in his mind as he moved about the kitchen softly, writing her breakfast things on the humpy tray. Gelid light and air were in the kitchen, but out of doors, gentle summer morning everywhere. Made him feel a bit peckish. The coals were reddening. Another slice of bread and butter. Three, four. Right. She didn't like her plate full. Right. He turned from the tray, lifted the kettle off the hob, and set it sideways on the fire. It sat there, dull and squat. Its spout stuck out. Cup of tea soon. Good. Mouth dry. The cat walked stiffly around a leg of the table with tail on high.
Meow.
Oh, there you are, Mr. Bloom said, turning from the fire. The cat meowed in answer and stalked again stiffly around a leg of the table, meowing. Just how she stalks over my writing table. Purr, scratch my head, purr. Mr. Bloom watched curiously, kindly the lithe black form. Clean to see, the gloss of her sleek hide, the white button under the butt of her tail, the green flashing eyes. He bent down to her, his hands on his knees. Milk for the pussins, he said.
Meow,
the cat cried. They call them stupid. They understand what we say better than we understand them. She understands all she wants to. Vindictive too, cruel her nature. Curious mice never squeal, seem to like it. Wonder what I look like to her. Height of a tower? No, she can jump me. Afraid of the chickens she is, he said mockingly. Afraid of the chuck-chucks. I never saw such a stupid pussins as the pussins.
Meow,
the cat said loudly. She blinked up out of her avid shame-closing eyes, meowing plaintively and long, showing him her milk-white teeth. He watched the dark eye slits narrowing with greed, till her eyes were green stones. Then he went to the dresser, took the jug Hanlon's milkman had just filled for him, poured warm bubbled milk on a saucer, and set it slowly on the floor. Grr, she cried, running to lap. He watched the bristles shining wirily in the weak light as she tipped three times and licked lightly. Wonder is it true if you clip them, they can't mouse after. Why? They shine in the dark, perhaps, the tips? Or kind of feelers in the dark, perhaps? He listened to her licking lap. Ham and eggs, no. No good eggs with this drought. One pure fresh water. Thursday, not a good day either for a mutton kidney at Buckley's. Fried with butter, a shake of pepper. Better a poor kidney at Duglax's, while the kettle is boiling. She lapped slower, then licking the saucer clean. Why are their tongues so rough? To lap better, all porous holes? Nothing she can eat? He glanced around him. No.
And I belong to a race too, says Bloom, that is hated and persecuted also now, this very moment, this very instant. Gob, he near burnt his fingers with the butt of his old cigar. Robbed, says he, plundered, insulted, persecuted, taking what belongs to us by right, at this very moment, says he, putting up his fist. Sold by auction off in Morocco like slaves or cattle. Are you talking about the New Jerusalem? Says the citizen. I'm talking about injustice, says Bloom. Right, says John Wyse. Stand up to it then with force, like men. That's an almanac picture for you. Mark for a soft-nosed bullet. Old lardy face standing up to the business end of a gun. Gob, he'd adorn a sweeping brush, so he would, if he'd only a nurse's apron on him. And then he collapses all of a sudden, twisting around all the opposite, as limp as a wet rag. But it's no use, says he. Force, hatred, history, all that. That's not life for men and women, insult and hatred. And everybody knows that it's the very opposite of that that is really life. What? Says Alf. Love, says Bloom. I mean, the opposite of hatred. I must go now, says he to John Wyse, just round to the court a moment to see if Martin is there. If he comes, just say I'll be back in a second, just a moment. Who's hindering you? And off he pops like greased lightning. A new apostle to the Gentiles, says the citizen. Universal love. Well, says John Wyse, isn't that what we're told? Love your neighbours. That chap, says the citizen. Beggar my neighbour is his motto. Love, Mario. He's a nice pattern of a Romeo and Juliet. Love loves to love love. Nurse loves the new chemist. Constable 14A loves Mary Kelly. Gertie McDowell loves the boy that has the bicycle. MB loves a fair gentleman. Lee Chi Han, lovey up, kissy cha, poo chow. Jumbo the elephant loves Alice the elephant. Old Mr. Verscoyle with the ear trumpet loves old Mrs. Verscoyle with the turned in eye. The man in the brown Macintosh loves a lady who is dead. His Majesty the King loves Her Majesty the Queen. Mrs. Norman W. Tupper loves Officer Taylor. You love a certain person, and this person loves that other person, because everybody loves somebody, but God loves everybody. Well, Joe, says I, your very good health and song. More power, citizen. Hurrah there, says Joe. The blessing of God and Mary and Patrick on you, says the citizen. And he ups with his pint to wet his whistle.
Thank you.
the world the mists began to fall. Out of the dreams that rose in happy throng, blow to our hearts love song, an old sweet song. And in the dusk where fell the firelight gleam, softly it wove itself into our dream. Just a song at twilight when the lights are low, and the flickering shadows softly
behaviour and obsession with the European cafe lifestyle of men in the 1920s, from his tireless wife and beloved daughter to his generous benefactor, Harriet Shaw Weaver, and of course the publisher which the ambassador referred to, Sylvia Beach, without whom this novel could not have come into being. And so it is no accident that Joyce's women spring to life in full colour. In a minute, Eileen will bring us the Sirens, Miss Lydia Deuce, Bronze, and Miss Mina Kennedy Gold, as we enter Ormond Bar, where the barmaids converse over tea, before Sinéad and I venture into the Penelopead to explore the different sections of Molly Bloom's mind in the final episode of Ulysses. Joyce chose June 16th, 1904 as the setting for the book, marking his first date with his future wife, Nora Barnacle. He adored Nora, and their marriage withstood a terribly turbulent wartime nomadic family life, jumping from city to city across Europe, from moments of great wealth and fame to times of poverty and great sickness. Molly Bloom became his fictional Nora, forever commemorated in his greatest work, and it's fitting, as in Ulysses, that she should have the final word. Then I am thrilled to leave you with Robert Finegan, Clara, Barbier, Serrano, and Tia Ling, whose siren song will bring our celebration to a close.
She poured the teacup tea, and then back in the teapot tea. They cowered under the reef of counter, waiting on footstools, crates upturned, waiting for their teas to draw. They pawed their blouses, both black satin, 2 and 9 a yard, waiting for their tees to draw, and 2 and 7. Yes, bronze from anear, by gold from afar, heard steel from anear, hoof rings from afar, heard steel hoofs, ring steel. Am I awfully sunburnt? Miss Bronze unbloused her neck. No, said Miss Kennedy. It gets brown after. Did you try the borax with the cherry laurel water? Miss Juice half stood to see her skin askance in the bar mirror, gilded letter where hock and claret glasses shimmered in the midst a shell. I'd leave it to my hands, she said. Try it with the glycerine, Miss Kennedy advised. Bidding her neck and hands adieu, Miss Juice. Those things only bring me out in a rash, replied Receded. I asked that old fogey and Boyd's for something for my skin. Miss Kennedy, now pouring full-drawn tea, grimaced and prayed, oh, don't remind me of him for mercy's sake. But wait till I tell you, Miss Juice entreated. Sweet tea, Miss Kennedy, having poured with milk, plucked both 2 ears with little fingers. No, don't, she cried. I won't listen, she cried, but blew. Miss Juice grunted in scruffy, foggy tones. For your what? Says he. Miss Kennedy unplugged her ears to hear, to speak, but said and prayed again, don't let me think of him or I'll expire, the hideous old wretch that night in ancient concert rooms. She sipped distastefully her brew, hot tea, a sip-sipped sweet tea. Here he was, Miss Juice said, cocking her bronze head 3/4, ruffling her nose wings. Hoofa, hoofa. Shrill shriek of laughter sprang from Miss Kennedy's throat. Miss Juice huffed and snorted down her nostrils that quivered impertinence like a shout in quest. Oh, shrieked Miss Kennedy, cried. Will you ever forget his goggle eye? Miss Juice chimed in deep bronze laughter, shouting, and your other eye. But whose dark eyes read Aaron the Gather's name? Why do I think the Gather, gathering figs, I think, and Prosper Lore's Huguenot name? By Bassie's blessed virgin, Bloom's dark eyes went by. Blue-robed, white under, come to me. God, they believe she is, or goddess. To those today, I could not see that fellow spoke a student after Daedalus's son. He might be Mulligan. All comely virgins that bring those rakes of fellows in her whites. By went his eyes, the sweets of sin, sweets are the sweets of sin. In a giggling peal of gold-bronze voices blended, Juice with Kennedy, your other eye, they threw young heads back, bronze giggle gold, and let freely their laughing, screaming, your other, signals to each other, high, piercing notes. Ah, panting, sighing, sighing, ah, for done their mirth die, die. Miss Kennedy lipped her cup again, raised and drank a sip and giggled. Miss Juice bended over the tree tay, ruffled again her nose and rolled drolled, fattened eyes. Again, Kennedy giggles, stooping her fair pinnacles of hair. Stooping, her tortoise nape comb showed, spluttering out her mouth, tea, choking, tea, laughter, coughing, choking, crying. Oh, greasy eyes, imagine being married to a man like that, she cried, with his bit of beard. Juice gave full vent to splendid yell, and full yell to full women, delight and joy and indignation. Married to his greasy nose, she yelled. Shrill, deep laughter of bronze and gold, they urged each other to peal after peal, ringing in changes, bronze, gold, gold, bronze, shrill, deep, to laughter after laughter, and then laughed more. Greasy eye nose! Exhausted, breathless, their shaken heads laid, braided and pinnacled by gloss combed against the counter ledge. All flushed, oh, panting, sweating, oh, and all breathless. Married to Bloom, a greasy's a bloom. Oh, saints above, Miss Juice said, sighed above her jumping rose. I wish I hadn't laughed so much, I feel all wet. Oh, Miss Juice, Miss Kennedy protested, you horrid thing, and flushed yet more, you horrid, more goldenly.
find Molly Bloom in bed with her iPad.
I don't care what anybody says. It'd be much better for the world to be governed by the women in it. You wouldn't see women going and killing one another and slaughtering. When do you ever see women rolling around drunk like they do, or gambling every penny they have and losing it on horses? Yes, because a woman, whatever she does, she knows where to stop. Sure, they wouldn't be in the world at all, only for us. They don't know what it is to be a woman and a mother. How could they? Where would they, all of them, be if they hadn't all a mother to look after them? What I never had. Oh, I'm not going to think myself into the glooms about that anymore. It's a lovely hour. So silent. I used to love coming home after dances. The air of the night. See, they have friends they can talk to. We've none. Either he wants what he won't get, or it's some woman ready to stick her knife in you. I hate that in women. No wonder they treat us the way we do. We're a dreadful lot of bitches. Suppose it's all the troubles we have that makes us so snappy. I'm not like that. Dedalus. I wonder it's like those names in Gibraltar. Delapath, Delagrathia. They had the divil's queer names there. Father Via Plana of Santa Maria that gave me the rosary. Rosales, the O'Reilly, and the Cayales Siesta Revueltas, and Pisimbo, and Mrs. Opisso in Governor Street. Oh, what a name! I'd go and drown myself in the first river if I had a name like her. Oh, my. And all the bits of streets, and Paradise Ramp, and Bedlam Ramp, and Rogers Ramp, and Crotchet's Ramp, and the Devil Gap Steps. Well, small blame to me if I am a harum scarum. I know I am a bit. I declare to God, I don't feel a day older than then. I'd love to have a long talk with an intelligent, well-educated person. I'd have to get a nice pair of red slippers like those Turks with the fez used to sell, or yellow, and a nice semi-transparent morning gown, that I badly want, or a peach blossom dressing jacket like the one Long Go and Walpole's, only 8 and 6, or 18 and 6. I'll just give him one more chance. I'll get up early in the morning. I'm sick of Cohen's old bed in any case. I might go over to the markets to see all the vegetables and cabbages and tomatoes and carrots and all kinds of splendid fruits all coming in lovely and fresh. Who knows, it'll be the first man I'd meet. They're out there, looking for it in the morning. Mammy Dillon used to say they are, and the night too. That was her mass going. A quarter after. What an unearthly hour. I suppose they're just getting up in China now, combing out their pigtails for the day. We'll soon have the nuns ringing their angelus. You see, they have nobody coming in to spoil their sleep, except for the odd priest or two for his night office. The alarm clock next door at cockshout, clattering the brains out of itself. Let me see if I can doze off. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What kind of flowers are those they invented like the stars?
As for them saying that there's no God,
I mean, I wouldn't give a snap me two fingers for all their learning. Why don't they go and create something, I often ask them. Atheists, or whatever they call themselves. Go and wash the cobbles off themselves first. And then they go howling for the priest and they dying. And why? Why? Because they're afraid of hell. On account of their bad conscience. Ah, yeah. I know them well. Who was the first person in the universe before there was anybody that made it all? Who? Ah, that they don't know. Neither do I. So there you are. They might as well try and stop the sun from rising tomorrow. The sun shines for you, he said. The day we were lying among the rhododendrons on Holt Head, in the grey tweed suit and his straw hat. The day I got him to propose to me. Yes. First, I gave him the bit of seed cake out of my mouth. And it was leap year, like now. Yes. 16 years ago. My God! After that long kiss, I near lost my breath. Yes. He said I was a flower of the mountain. Yes. So we are. Flowers. All a woman's body. Yes. That was one true thing he said in his life. And the sun shines for you today. Yes. That was why I liked him. Because I saw he understood or felt what a woman is. And I knew I could always get round him. And I gave him all the pleasure I could, leading him on, till he asked me to say yes. And I wouldn't answer first, only looked out over the sea and the sky. And I was thinking of so many things he didn't know of Mulvey, and Mr. Stanhope, and Hester, and Father, and old Captain Groves, and the sailors, playing All Birds Fly, and I Say Stoop, and washing up dishes, they called it on the pier, and the sentry in front of the governor's house with the thing round his white helmet. Poor devil, half roasted. And the Spanish girls laughing in their shawls and their tall combs. And the auctions in the morning. The Greeks and the Jews and the Arabs and the devil knows who else from all ends of Europe. And Duke Street and the foul market all sucking outside Larby Sharon's. And the poor donkeys slipping half asleep. And the vague fellas in the cloaks, asleep in the shade of the steps, and the big wheels of the carts of the bulls, and the old castle, thousands of years old, yes, and those handsome Moors, all in white and turbans like kings, asking you to sit down in their little bit of a shop, and Rhonda, with the old windows of the Posadas, glancing eyes, a lattice hid for her lover to kiss the iron. And the wine shops half open at night. And the castanets. And the night we missed the boat at Algeciras. And the watchman going about serene with his lamp. And oh, that awful deep down torrent. Oh, and the sea, crimson, sometimes like fire. And the glorious sunsets, and the fig trees in the Alameda Gardens, yes. And all the queer little streets, and pink and blue and yellow houses, and rose gardens, and the jessamine and geraniums, and cactuses, and Gibraltar as a girl, where I was a flower of the mountain, yes. When I put the rose in my hair like the Andalusian girls used. Or shall I wear a red? Yes. And how he kissed me under the Moorish wall. And I thought, well, as well him as another. And then I asked him with my eyes to ask again. Yes. And then he asked me, would I? Yes, to say yes, my mountain flower. And first, I put my arms around him, yes, and drew him down to me so he could feel my breasts all perfume, yes. And his heart was going like mad. And yes, I said, yes, I will, yes.
Oh. Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our formal program for this evening. But on behalf of us all, I just want to thank very much our readers and our singers and our musicians and our composer for a beautiful, very versatile offering. And I think its very versatility, I think, reflects very much the kind of the complexity and diversity of Joyce himself, you know, kind of from the traditional pastiche of Phil the Fluter's Ball on the one hand, kind of to the modernity of the Sirens and the other, and all the kind of themes reflected in the readings. On the one hand, this very particularity of Dublin that's reflected in the novel, but that also all the references back to the classics and to Spain and Morocco and so forth. So extraordinary diversity and complexity. I heard last weekend that, you know, I was doing my research, I was listening to a podcast about Joyce, and I was very struck that apparently a friend of his close to the end of his life said, would you ever think about returning to Dublin? And he said, returning? Sure, I've never left. And I think that was evident in the readings this evening.